used to spend my nights out in barrooms.
Jeffrey, you singing?
I'll take it away.
Liquor was the only love.
Sing it.
No, no. Yep.
Have the Northwest Georgia industry update, gentlemen. How are you?
Excellent. How are you doing, Brett?
I am doing great. One of my favorite things to do is sit here and talk about all the stuff going on in the world, from numbers to trends to things that we need to know about, and all the above, right? So let's dive in here. Let me get my screen share pulled up here. And let's move over here to Bartow. Tell me what's going on in Bartow County, gentlemen. We've got 40 new listings in the last 7 days. The week before, we had 63, 68 the week before that, and 58 the week before that. So certainly kind of died off a little bit last 7 days. If you look at our chart here, looks like a squiggly mess, but what I'm noticing is the blue line going way down and the red line and the yellow line going up, which is interesting because that means the inventory is going to tighten a little bit, which you haven't really seen that up there.
No, but it's one of our agents the other day was saying it's the first time in about a year and a half things have felt a little normal for the time of the year. It feels like a Thanksgiving, Christmas season from a few years ago. It's the first time, like, it's okay, I understand this feeling at this time of the year.
Yeah. So,
which was an interesting perspective.
Well, hang on though. I want you to develop that a little bit. What does that mean?
So yeah, we were talking about the seasonality of real estate, and nothing over the past year and a half has been predictable or even felt what they've been used to pre-COVID and pre-everything happening. But this is a little bit what things have felt like in terms of the week before Thanksgiving and leading up to Christmas and the conversations they're having with their listing clients, especially about getting ready for the holidays and wanting to list after the holidays are over, things like that. So it kind of was a little bit of a breath of fresh air for her as she was discussing it with me.
Yeah, so I would just add on to that.
Say that there's an article that says seasonality is back. and iBuying is alive. We've seen all that, right?
Yeah.
Certainly a hot topic. What were you going to say, Matt?
Yeah, I would just add on to what Jeffrey's saying. I think it's a great conversation to have with clients to be careful that are we comparing the seasonality this year against last year, where everything got shifted towards the end of the year with the pandemic? Or should we look back at 2019 data, which we should, and see what seasonality really looks like compared to 2021 as we get back on track to a normal seasonality, a normal expectation of what the market looks like?
Yeah. So are we safe to compare it to 2019, or do we compare it to where 2020 was? What is the correct mindset to have in comparing these statistics? Yeah,
great question. 2019.
Okay.
Remember, the pandemic hit in February or March of 2020. So we all turned New Year's Eve on 2020 with the 2020 vision, right? We were all excited and it was a big milestone, and then wham. And but if you think about that fourth quarter 2019, it felt pretty normal.
Mm-hmm.
And fourth quarter 2020 did not.
No.
So what's interesting, Jeffrey, is your comment you made about the agent saying it feels like a holiday season is normal. Well, 2019's holiday season was pretty normal.
Mm-hmm.
And so we only had one disrupted holiday season. If you think about it.
Interesting.
But everybody feel we're all in post-traumatic stress disorder right now. Like, we feel like it's been going on forever. But it's only been about 18 months, right?
Yep.
All right. So in Gordon County, let's look here. We had 18 new listings, 22 pending, 17 closings. Going back, you can kind of see we went from 27, 32, 26, 28, 18. I'm guessing it's just a low month. I mean, I'm sorry, a low week.
Yeah, I mean, you see it at the first week of October. It looks like every month you have that low week. It may change a little bit about in what week it is, but it just looks like a low week comparative to the other weeks that go on through the month. So I wouldn't raise too many red flags at that.
Not at all. And in Floyd County up in Rome, Georgia, we had 31 new listings, 19 pending and 21 closed. That actually held pretty constant to the previous weeks, right? So Rome stayed pretty constant in new listings coming on the market. Closings was pretty constant. Of course, if you look a month ago, we only had 11 closings that week. So Rome seems pretty stable and pretty strong right now. The others are, you know, it's an off week, big deal, right? Anything else you'd add on the numbers, guys?
No, I mean, it's just a matter of knowing it and knowing what the numbers mean. I know we talk about this every month when we do these calls, but this is valuable, valuable resource and information, especially when you're working with buyers to be able to say, hey, this is only 31 homes came on the market this week. So if you kind of like this house, let's jump on it.
There you go.
It is interesting to see if you hop down to expired the last 5-6 weeks, we've had 2 expired in Floyd County, yeah. Which is
Gordon County.
Gordon County, you've had 4.
Were in Bartow, 5.
Yeah. So that has not changed much, even with normal seasonality.
Yeah. I'll just remind everybody, if you go to the website, therealestatestats.com, it'll take you to this spreadsheet. So you can go look anytime you need to. Therealestatestats.com. Okay. Jeffrey, or actually Matt, you wanted to talk about this article on Inman about off-season rebound for mortgages could bode well for fall home sales. Tell me what I need to know.
I thought it was interesting because, you know, we're comparing year over year and applications this past 2 weeks, according to this article, are up almost 8% year over year for mortgage applications. So as the predictors of what mortgages will and will not do put out their data and their predictions, you can see at the chart here, we're expecting by 2022 to be at a lot of this at 3.4 or higher, 4 in some cases. So I always, you know, a general rule of thumb is getting this information in front of your clients to talk about, hey, here's what rates are looking like, what the experts are predicting to happen. And with pricing, Brett, and how expensive things are getting, 4% is a big, that will take a ton of people out of the market who may could get in the market right now, you know, with the prediction of housing to continue to go up by 4% and rates to go up by 1%, they could get into some decent property now, which in a year from now, it doesn't look like affordability will be an option. So that's just what I saw from the article. And
so, I was going to say, Matt, on that note, answer this question that we get asked as agents all the time. Is right now a good time to buy a house or should I wait?
Well, I guess the question is, why do you need to move, Jeffrey?
Good question, Matt. You know, I mean, yeah, I want to get a good deal.
What's a good deal?
I want a good deal. Should I wait until, see if the houses, I mean, until it crashes?
Well, that's what we're hearing. As Brett would teach you, tell me, develop that a little bit. What's a good deal?
Well, there we go. Here we go. Okay. So if you're paying attention on the coach Matt here helping us, a good deal is I want my lowest, cheapest house payment and I want the largest house possible.
Great. So I guess, Jeffrey, if you're looking at these mortgage rates that we have on the screen here and they're predicting to go up and you see that appreciation's going up by 4%, would you say now is a better time to buy or a year from now?
Well, don't you think that the housing prices are going to drop drastically in the next 6 months?
Did you get the data that I sent over to you from the great charts that Brett creates for us?
No, I need to look at that, don't I?
Yeah.
So now is a good time to buy.
Well, yes and no. Yes, it's always a great time to buy if it's the circumstances are right for you. Interest rates are going to go up. We know that. That's a truth, right? it's not even so much a prediction at this point. We understand they're coming up. Inflation is high right now, which means people are having less disposable income to put towards debt service. So the way I explain it is most of your lenders will say, if your gross income is blank, we'll let you put 40% of that gross income towards debt service, credit cards, cars, mortgage payment, that kind of thing, right? So that means 60% of your gross income, you figure most people are on 30% tax rate, right? So that leaves 30% of their income to be able to spend. Groceries, gas, all the above, right? Yep. Well, you know, there's an article. Let me see if I can find it. Yeah, here. So here's all the inflation from a year ago. So 41 cents for a dozen eggs doesn't sound like a lot of money. But when it adds up, it takes a lot of money out of people's pockets that aren't living with that big margin.
Right? Yeah.
Look at bacon.
Yeah.
It looks like, Brett, if you'd added all that up, you know, because that's a normal grocery shopping list, you're at 15, 20% of an increase in the total bill.
So, of course. Yeah. So it takes money out of people's pockets if their income isn't going up proportionately, right? Yeah. Which most people's income is not. Real estate agents' income is. One, because we're doing a great job of helping people make more money, but two, the market's also given real estate agents a gift of price appreciation because we're paid on a percentage of price, right? Mm-hmm. So if price goes up 15%, we in theory get a 15% raise. Well,
yeah, that's what we tell people, you know, in our office, we're up 24% in GCI percentage. Corporate America is up 4%.
Right. But here's what you got to know, Jeffrey, is if I buy today or I want to wait a year from now, what's the difference in interest rate? Probably going to be 0.5%, right? Maybe even a 0.5%. I'm probably going to have another 15% price appreciation. So I'm going to have to pay more for the house a year from now. And it's going to cost, the cost of money will be higher a year from now. And I don't know what my income's going to look like, nor do I know what inflation's going to look like.
Right.
But there's a lot of factors that people are just kind of trying to navigate here. All that being said, every one of those factors points to now's a better time to buy than over there. As long as you're responsibly buying and not buying above your means and things like that.
Yeah.
And this is great, great information that puts us in the seat to be the professional in the conversation. People are looking to us to be the professional. And when we don't act like the professional, they're running to the Zillows and the Open Doors because they seem like they have a grasp on the market. But
I buy it as a lie, we haven't talked.
We haven't done a video since all of the Zillow stuff.
Tell me about it.
Yeah, let's break it down. Matt, share with us if you haven't heard and you've been living under
Matt? He brought it up and then he pawned it off on you.
I'll break it down for you. Yeah, so I think we're 3-4 weeks out. Zillow paused iBuying completely, right? Some numbers reports came out and they have to report and are held to a standard by their investors and it didn't look good. Their iBuying numbers, they were losing a lot. That being said, I think you can see in this article, iBuying other companies, Opendoor, OfferPad, are still full in on iBuying and still moving forward. So, you know, as far as Zillow, they have paused. They are done with that. It's not their one thing. Zillow has a lot of other avenues that they make money on. Yet iBuying is still alive and you will see Opendoor and OfferPad promoting and marketing like no other. As agents, we should be putting out what we like to call MOFRs to let these people know and let our clients know that we can offer the same exact product and be there to stand by their side as a fiduciary. Brett?
Yeah, so Opendoor sends me a marketing piece on a rental property I own in Texas, and they find me in Georgia. Hmm. And it's a pretty actually good marketing piece. How Open Door compares, directly sell it Open Door the traditional way. But then they put this letter together and it said, lock in your offer today and get a stress-free seal. Here's your estimated value. You can get a competitive cash offer, skip stressful home showing to prep work, choose the close date that works for you, right? Pretty easy little messaging and marketing. The whole point of it though is people are raising their hand to Open Door, but not raising their hand to you. Mm-hmm. And they're in our database. So I got a little proactive, gentlemen. And if you go to the kweasybutton.com, okay, and you click on the freebies and you click on this selling your home, I created my own letter.
Oh, great.
And it says, selling your home stress-free with options. Dear Brett, want to know what your home is worth? Based on recent home sales, we could make a cash offer between blank. Your estimated value is this. Contact me for an equity analysis on your home.
Why did you choose the term equity analysis versus CMA?
Nobody knows what the heck a CMA is anyway.
Exactly.
And two, I think everybody has equity now and they want to know about that. And it's enticing. So I created this flyer. Here's the best part. If you download this, all these spaces are open fields for you to go in and put all your information. And if you know somebody smart that knows how to do mail merge, they can go mail merge this whole thing, right?
And that's free.
But this is us taking control and going back into the game of saying, hey, quit calling all the iBuyers. Call me as your real estate consultant. I've got options.
I closed a killer offer yesterday. It was fantastic. It is a great, great option for your listing and your sellers. If you're watching this video and need more information, let me know. Because walked through it step by step, closed, got my clients probably about 15 grand more than they were expecting, and probably more than I would have listed it for, being honest. So it was a great solution for them.
Awesome. The other thing I think our agents need to be aware of is there's this thing called listing attribution. And there's actually two things. There's listing attribution and buyer commission disclosure. And last week was the National Association of Realtors convention, and there are some big names and big opposing forces with differing opinions. So it's funny, if you look at this article, talks about our competitor Remax urges NAR to reject the listing attribution proposal, where Zillow and Realty push for the listing attribution agent attribution. What on earth am I talking about? What is this? So what happens, gentlemen, is we list property and we put that property in the MLS, and the MLS pushes the data through IDX to third-party websites. That's how we get all the data on our websites. So then the question becomes, how do we disclose that listing on a third-party website? Do you hide the listing agent and broker and just try to push out a premier agent like Zillow did for a long time? Or do you push forward the listing agent and the listing broker? Here's the irony of this. Nobody's arguing whether or not to disclose who listed the house. They're actually arguing to disclose just the broker or the broker and the agent. Well, our company philosophy all these years has been your listings, your leads. And we believe as an agent-centric company that the consumer chooses you to do business with. So we're all about making sure you're disclosed on your listings as the listing agent. But I find it interesting when other companies want the disclosure to only be the broker. Like, it's a very traditional mindset and a very broker-centric mindset, which I'm not saying they're right and we're wrong, or we're right and they're wrong. I'm just going to say that we don't believe that that's the best way to do business. How's that? However, it's a hot topic in being debated at the national level right now, and you should be aware of what's going on because it affects your lead generation ability of tomorrow, one, right, in how data is shared. The other thing that's hot topic right now is they have voted to disclose the buyer commission to the consumer. So in the past, it was put in MLS that we were offering a 3% buyer commission or 2% or 2.5% on foreclosure properties and things like that, right? But it was never really advertised that way to where the consumer had a looking glass into it. And they're expecting it to be more advertised with a looking glass to the consumer, which I find interesting. What do y'all say?
It's honestly, Brett, it's all new to me and discovering and researching it. I don't know that I have a strong opinion yet, you know, because this is new to me. I don't know. I wouldn't be a good voice on an opinion. Matt, what do you think?
I would just, you know, either way it goes, if they do display buyer agent commission, I think it's just a great, another training opportunity for our agents and how we disclose and how we talk and how we handle objections around it. So I know either way it goes, as KW agents, we'll be prepared and pivot and make sure we're ready to handle with scripts those questions that we may or may not get. As far as my listing, my lead, I'm all for it. As you know, I think it is the way to do business. And you know, I would hope that they push in that direction. I'm sure it's a lot of pressure from both sides. So.
Yep. So here's the statement. This is what you need to know. The policy, and by the way, they approved it. The policy required MLSs to display buyer broker commissions on their listing sites and to include buyer broker commissions in the data feeds they provide to agents and brokers. Your website, every listing is going to show the buyer commission, but does not require that the brokers and agents using the feeds display buyer broker commission. So they have to push it out, but I'm not sure it's saying we have to disclose it yet. So it's an ongoing conversation, but it's certainly a change to our industry. I think consumers are going to try to negotiate that commission with us, or that's kind of one of the thought processes around that. As I said, I promise to bring all the news, not the happy news only. But at the end of the day, we just want to be aware of what's going on in our industry.
I mean, it pushes me as an agent to make sure whichever way this swings, that my client realizes the value that I bring to the equation. That, yep. What's it, in the absence of value, you know, that's, people are looking for a cost reduction or whatever the, you know, the statement is. If I'm bringing about a strong amount of value and high value, it shouldn't matter.
There you go.
Yeah, I would add, I mean, value is everything. Jeffrey crushed it right there. In the end of any timeline, the consumer is going to get what they want. We know that. And I don't think it's a bad thing. I think listing agents have been handling objections about their commissions at the table their whole entire career. I don't know why buyer's agents can't prepare and handle the same. And it will, make it more pertinent to have an incredible value proposition so you can handle that objection.
There you go. All right, gentlemen. Jeff, are you ready to sing?
Let's go.
Hi, guys.